So welcome. I am Gijssen de Vries. I'm associate professor at the University of Groningen, fellow of the Groningen Growth and Development Center. I'd like to thank you for attending this speed round. Probably if they figured out, my co-authors are also in this speed round and they'll be happy to answer any questions that you have in the chat during the presentation. What we do in this paper is we examine recent patterns of industrialization across developing economies. And what we do is we introduce the GTDC UNU wider economic transformation database, which includes consistent time series information on manufacturing output and employment alongside a lot of other information. So the data set has variables on persons engaged, real and nominal value added in domestic currencies for 12 sectors of the total economy. So sectors like agriculture, mining, manufacturing, and other sectors. And then for 51 countries slash economies in Asia, Africa, and Latin America. And there's annual data from 1990 to 2018. And this data set has been constructed based on an in-depth investigation of the availability and reliability of statistical sources, which was done on a country-by-country basis. And this data set will be publicly released at the UNU Wider and at GGDC on Wednesday, February 17, 2021. Along with the public release, there will also be a technical working paper describing all the sources and methods in detail on a country-by-country basis. Now, in this paper, we use the economic transformation database to step into the debate about the patterns of industrialization in developing countries. And in particular, we aim to contribute to the question about the industrialization opportunities that are there for countries at lower levels of income. And actually, that's a debate that will also be continued by Emmanuel Mensah this Friday at the STEG conference in another speed round. And what scholars have been doing is documenting patterns of deindustrialization in actually in much of the developing world during the 1990s and early 2000s. And that's a rather worrisome finding, as it suggests that the traditional route to development has been cut off. And at the same time, there's also been other scholars, including Mensah, but also Diao and Macmillan, that have argued that especially in the context of Africa, it's rather soon to conclude actually that countries are running out of industrialization opportunities, that in fact, there might be an issue with the sample of countries that has been considered so far. So what we do and what I'm going to present now, since it's a speed round, is to show you our baseline econometric model, which we use, and that's an econometric model that's part of a long tradition in development economics, starting with Hollis Chenery in the 60s, but recently popularized by Danny Roderick in his 2016 Journal of Economic Growth paper. And what we aim to capture then is industrialization patterns, where we use period dummies for the 2000s and the 2010s. And in the next slide, I will report the estimated coefficients of these period dummies. So these period dummies show the manufacturing employment share of each period relative to the excluded decade of the 1990s. So presented here are regressions for the global sample, which is in the first column, and then for the regions, which is in subsequent columns. And the table reports results where the dependent variable is the manufacturing employment share. And the key parameters of interest here are actually have these boxes around them. They relate to the decade fixed effects for the 2000s and then relative to the 1990s. And in the first column with this blue box shows that in the aggregate sample, the Cadel dummy for the zeros is actually significantly smaller compared to the 90s. Suggesting deindustrialization, yet the decadal dummy for the 10s is not significantly different from the dummy for the 1990s. Subsequent columns show regressions by region, And he suggests that deindustrialization continued in the tens in high-income Asia, but not in developing Asia, where there was a higher manufacturing share in the tens compared to the 90s. Results for Latin America are comparable to the aggregate sample, but probably most notable are the estimates for the for sub-Saharan Africa, where in the final column, Mauritius is included per the type of regressions that Danny Roderick also was running in his Journal of Economic Growth paper. And there, the coefficients suggest an about 1.9 percentage point higher manufacturing employment share in the 10s compared to the 90s. So this suggests a recovering of manufacturing by about half of the downward shift that was observed in decades before. So in the 90s and early 2000s, deindustrialization was widespread across Latin America, Sub-Saharan Africa. But our main finding is that it appears that that trend has reversed. And in this paper, we examine industrialization where we pay attention to the sample of countries from the region and also to country heterogeneity. We document an expansion actually in the manufacturing employment share for quite a few countries in Asia and Sub-Saharan Africa and also a few in Latin America. And we think these findings carry rather important implications for the opportunities for future growth and poverty reduction in these countries. At the same time, we're also quite well aware that they create a lot of new questions. And particularly, why has there been this reversal in the industrialization trend? And what is actually the nature of these manufacturing activities that are expanding? In particular, we're interested in understanding whether it's actually the expansion of modern manufacturing firms in Sub-Saharan Africa. Actually, we're working on those questions on the nature of industrialization, and we hope to provide further information and findings on this at future STEC Advance to advance this debate. I'm happy to discuss this further. I'm aware of the timing, the clock I see running. I'm happy to discuss this further here or in an offline setting. You can see my email address at the bottom. So that's it. Thanks for your attention.
Aitzen, can you tell us a little bit of the transformation database, how that compares to the 10 sector database? It's a wider set of countries, different set of years. Can you tell us a little bit?
Yes, I'll be happy to do. I put up this slide already for those of you to look at the type of countries, the type of sectors that are there. I can see that it didn't totally appear adequately in terms of the sectors that are distinguished. But that's one of the differences, actually, that there's a slightly larger sector coverage, but probably the biggest difference is that this follows the industrial standard in the International Standard Industrial Classification Revision 4, where in particular you have this distinction of business services, which might be relevant for other lines of research future on. So that's one difference compared to the GGDC 10 sector database. Another difference indeed is the extension of the country sample. And in particular there has been more lower income countries added to the data set. So that's, we also think is an important extension. And then finally, the 10 sector database had data running until around 2011, 2012. Now that has been updated to 2018. I guess some other scholars will ask, okay, where are other countries like the EU countries, the US, Japan? Those, I'm happy to provide you with further directions, but those are constructed in the EU CLEMS project. So if you go to euclems.eu, you can actually find this data for a much wider set of countries, mostly high income countries there. I see you nodding, Joe, so I guess you're satisfied with this answer.
So, guys, and I have another question. So, how important do you think is sample selection here? Because there is maybe 50 countries in Sub-Saharan Africa, and you list South Africa and Ethiopia and all the countries that have been doing well for the last decades, but you don't list Congo.
Yes, definitely. So I can approach your question. I think this is Joe. This is the other Joey, right? From Leuven.
Yes, it was me.
Yes. Okay. I didn't see your face, but I could recognize your voice. I think I can approach your question in two ways. One way is that we think that currently the findings on deindustrialization actually relate to the countries that are included. In the previous 10 sector database on which a lot of these findings on deindustrialization were based, actually there were 11 African countries. Here we have 18. And I could not show these results, but actually we find that it depends a lot on the sample of countries that you consider for sub-Saharan Africa, whether you find deindustrialization or industrialization. But your question is more on, okay, there's actually a selection that you do in the type of countries where countries like the Congo or others are actually excluded because it's notoriously hard to obtain these type of data. And even if you manage to do so, then the margin of error is going to be substantial. I think that's a fair point.
But I think it's systematic. I think in order to do manufacturing, you need to have a machine, but the machine gets stolen, so you don't do manufacturing. And so systematically, the countries which are doing bad are not going to be in your data.
Yes, yes. I think that might be a fair point indeed. Although the only thing I can respond to that at this stage is that we actually, in this project for this database, we made quite a bit of effort to extend the set of countries that are there. So in that sense, your point is well taken, and I agree with that, but it might actually apply stronger to the previous database than this version, as there's a wider set of countries included here.
Yeah, I agree. I just mean, keep working. Keep working.
Thanks.
So just one comment from me, El Hajj. We're running out of time, but for me, this is good news because we are trying to push for industrialization. And we believe that everything is not lost. There is still opportunities to industrialize. And in terms of country selection, when I look at your sample, yes, it's the countries doing well, but also, those countries that are not included, many of them haven't been doing much in many years. So including them will just skew the data and you will not find something meaningful. So we have like 20 fragile countries in Africa, right? So in these countries, it's either war, it's either climate fragility and others that prevent them from advancing. But you have a group of countries that have been growing fast, that have been doing well. And some of these countries are pushing for industrialization so that you can find in this group of countries. So I know time is good. We finished. So I'll contact you and we'll chat more. Thanks. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Thank you for this. Indeed, I see a countdown. I put up here my email address. I'm very happy to discuss this further in an offline setting or during the conference. And I look forward to further discussions on this. Many thanks for your attention.